Hey guys, welcome back. If you're new to the channel, be sure to subscribe so you can catch the spills every week. And don't forget to hit that bell up top so you can squat up in the comments for the first hour. Alright, so for this one, we're going to switch it up a little bit and talk about Storm conquering Wakanda. And this is something that I got from X-Men Forever, which was written by Chris Claremont in like your 2009-2010. And I've always looked at this run like a what-if series. Because back in 09, Chris Claremont came back to the X-Men title, and with X-Men Forever, he gave us this kind of mashup of what he would have put in the series had he continued to write for X-Men. And that's not to say had he stayed in the early and mid-90s, it went down this way exactly, because it still would have had to gone through the editor-in-chief. But with X-Men Forever, he got the opportunity to play with the 161 universe, which obviously was a direct flip off of your 616 universe, and that allowed him to take certain risks that wouldn't have exactly flied if he stayed back in 92-93. And one of those main concepts that we're going to talk about here is Storm killing Wolverine, turning on the X-Men, and then taking Wakanda. So pretty much Storm takes over the world. And I always felt like the cover of this specific issue had Wolverine's clothes kind of pointing to Storm, or at least trying to. Kind of in a way just saying that she did it, bub. But nah, really. What I like about this concept is that it takes a character like Storm, who's normally not in the forefront, and she doesn't have any of your like Scarlet Witch, House of M storylines where you see how crazy powerful she is by nearly wiping out every mutant in existence, but even without her doing that, we still know that she's wildly powerful. And the main reason why we haven't seen it for the most part is because it's her choice. She chooses to show restraint. She chooses not to use lethal force. And that's the way that she's usually written. And to really grasp the concept of how potentially powerful that Storm is, I have to say one of the best comparisons is when she went up against Silver Surfer. In this one we talked about a few weeks back where Black Panther ultimately had to figure out a way to stop the Silver Surfer and Galactus. But before that actually took place, Storm showed us that she can control elements even in outer space, and even create an entire atmosphere around a single object. Which kind of leaves you to think, what if she had the elements and gases that stretched over billions of miles, that she could just manipulate like clay? Like, the possibilities are just mind-blowing. But the way that all this went down as far as her fallout with the X-Men, Chris Claremont really took the route of what if Storm wasn't who she said she was. And he does this by having Storm go through the transmodification process. She's also de-aged to about 11 years old, or like your teenage, early teenage years. And once again, this is a specific reimagining of Chris Claremont's run in the early 90s with X-Men Extinction Agenda. And that's one of the main reasons why your 161 universe is very similar to your 616. And what X-Men Forever does, it really just takes the events from Extinction Agenda, and it really just continues that event moving forward. And the way that this went down is because Wolverine was the first one to catch on to her. And if you're wondering why he has five claws here, it's because Kitty Pryde was merged with more than one person at a time, and one of his claws got stuck in her when they separated. But at this point, Wolverine has become suspicious of Storm, so he starts following her, but he really doesn't tell anybody. The only person who really knows is Jean, and that's mainly because of their close history in this universe. And even though later on she would go on to be with Cyclops, she still found out over the course of time that she had these deep feelings for him. And when Logan first left the mansion, most were under the guise that he just left because what they recently found out about S.H.I.E.L.D. keeping a close eye on the mansion, and they just thought he was mad and he stormed out, no pun intended. But when he left, he was really tying things together because he was suspicious of Storm, and he also noticed that S.H.I.E.L.D. was too. But for Logan, it was more kind of a red flag the last time they faced Magneto, and in that matchup, it was almost like she was trying to take some of them out at the same time. But it's when he gets to the secret penthouse where he gets struck by lightning, and it's crazy, like it's made to look like an explosion, but it literally wiped him out down to the bone. And even though he was connected with Jean, this happened so quick that she couldn't warn him to get out. Like, she was trying to, but it happened like in mid-sentence. And at the moment that this happened, keep in mind, him and Jean are linked. She's still in love with him. And in mid-sentence of talking to him, he's killed. And for her, emotionally, it's like getting hit by a truck. And in the 161 universe, this is how the Phoenix Force comes about. And instead of it being its own entity, here it's like her power is just going to the next level. And it literally lays out everybody who's close around Jean at the mansion. And it put Jean in a coma of sorts. So what Charles Xavier decided to do while she was in the infirmary was kind of help her through back to consciousness, because she took the worst hit. And they weren't sure if what happened was an attack from like an alien force or anything like that. So Charles checked that first, saw she was clean. But while he was in there, he also observed a number of Jean's memories which kept playing over and over. And it was here that he discovered more about the history between Logan and Jean. And it even went to the extent where he discovered where Logan was about to tell Jean how he still felt around the time of their last mission, because it was a near-death experience with the Blackbird crashing. And this revealed to us at this moment that even though she was with Scott, that Logan and Jean were still kind of drawn close back together. And this accumulation of memories led all the way up to his time of death, one by one. And it took him back to the scene in that apartment where Wolverine was murdered, or penthouse better yet, because it wasn't just an apartment. But I just want to clear that up for somebody to go crazy in the comments. But either way, still, when this happens, Charles is given a front row seat with the same view that Jean witnessed from when she was trying to tell him to get out of there. And when this happened, man, it escalated quick. Because after this, with everybody there at the mansion in the infirmary, it was made pretty clear that Storm killed him. And man, Jean was pissed. She went honey-baked ham on that girl. And this was a huge shock to everybody, because nobody at this point in time had any idea that this wasn't the real Storm. No, I take that back. There was one exception, and it happened after the death of Wolverine. Like, right after when everybody was just coming to. Because at that time, Storm was just tiptoeing back in the mansion. And when she was coming in, Sabretooth had crept up behind her. And okay, I got a confession to make. Because in the last video I did, talking about the Marvel 1610 universe and how it's officially back, I kind of drop a bomb on some of you guys, letting you know that in that universe, Sabretooth is Wolverine's son. I gotta admit, because of that video, that's what kind of inspired me to talk about this story. Plus, with Black Panther coming up, there's a few things that tie into here real sweet. But as far as dropping bombs, here comes another one. Because Sabretooth in this 161 universe is actually Wolverine's dad. And he's here to get revenge on his son's killer. And I believe the way it went down is he picked up Storm's scent from the site where Wolverine was killed at, and that's how he followed her back here. But when he attacks her, she kind of fights her way into an open area, which happens to be the danger room. And also because she's less effective in tight areas because the lack of moisture, which makes her less powerful in a closed space. And that feeling of less power also contributes to her claustrophobia, which isn't good. It's just a bad combination altogether for her. But when the X-Men see Storm fighting Sabretooth, like, immediately their reaction is to help Storm. And that makes sense, because at this point, Jean didn't reveal who really killed him. Not yet, because this happened right before they went inside the infirmary, Charles stepped into Jean's mind and everybody found out. And after Sabretooth had attacked Storm, they didn't listen to much of what he said. They just locked him up, really because of who he is and who he's been, and they just went on about their business. But fast forwarding over to where the X-Men really found out who this Storm was, they immediately blitzed her, but she wasn't trying to get taken into custody. So she fought back in order to make her escape. And when the truth was revealed, she really wasn't trying to hide it no more, because at this point, it's like, why be a fraud anymore? But the crazy thing that happens here, which is kind of a twist of poetic justice, because as soon as Storm tries to make her way out, Kitty Pryde uses that one claw which she got when she was fused with Wolverine, leaving a scar on this version of Storm's face. And it's poetic justice, because she still gets out of there. But for the rest of her life, she has a reminder across her face of the person she killed. And it was put there by Logan's claw on top of that. It's crazy. But immediately after that, she makes her way over to Wakanda. And while she's en route over here, she's severely wounded. She took a number of cuts from Sabretooth's claws, which for the record are just made of bone. They're not adamantium in the 161 universe. But that Wolverine claw, that was adamantium all day. But Storm makes her way all the way to Wakanda from the Xavier Mansion, and she is severely wounded. She's lost a lot of blood. And one of the critical things to keep in mind is when Storm was reversed back to a younger age and cloned, her memories from that younger age all the way up to her adult self, that portion of her consciousness was separated and put away. And so this copy of Storm, she does remember all of Storm's younger experiences, which is why she does remember T'Challa. And that's part of the reason she came all this way, to use Wakanda kind of as a place of refuge for her to hide away as a wanted criminal. And a number of organizations are aware that she went to Wakanda, and that's mainly because they tracked her flight pattern by satellite. And so T'Challa of this 161 universe, he is insanely in love with Storm. And I mean insanely and blindly in love with Storm. Because Nick Fury FaceTimed him and told him what happened at the X-Mansion. Because Nick Fury was there. And when he told T'Challa that this isn't the same Storm that you remember, T'Challa responded that he ran every single test on her DNA and everything came through positive, confirming that it was still her. And just to put this out there for any of the 616 Black Panther fans, in the 616 universe, this would never happen. And we know that for a fact because of the Skrull invasion, because of Secret Invasion. Because at that time, the Skrulls had found a way to completely blend in and even pass every DNA test. And Black Panther knew the difference with his people by being able to look into their souls. And with this version of Storm even being a copy of the original one down to the soul, she didn't start being evil until she encountered the Shadow King. And it's not that the Shadow King possessed her, but he corrupted this copy. And 616 Black Panther would have tested further and found that. But because this Black Panther in the 161 universe is so love-stricken, he only tested that her DNA would pass, and after that, he just wanted to believe that she came back to be with him. And when she came back, she did a lot of good things to prove her affection. She helped give sufficient rain and nourishment to the vegetation. She helped with the weather conditions for construction. Like, if it's not raining, you know, things get done a lot quicker. And she also helped as far as fighting alongside with Wakanda in the defense of the country. But that just brings me to the point of telling all you young fellas out there, if you meet a lady and she falls through a window into your life, and I don't care how beautiful she is, man, look into her past. Because there's a lot of frauds out here who running away from something when you meet them. And I'm just gonna leave that right there. But for real though, she helped clean things up, she helped put away Killmonger. She pretty much had her hands everywhere in Wakanda that they could be, helping out in some sort of way or fashion. And because of this, the people of Wakanda fell in love with her as well. And as T'Challa said, many of them even worshipped her. And with her being here to stay, T'Challa decided that he should marry her as well. And I'm just shaking my head right now, cause background check, brothers, I'm just saying. You gonna learn today. And so on their wedding day, as Storm was getting ready for the ceremony, Killmonger, who was a prisoner in Wakanda at the time, he sneaks up behind Storm and places the device on her neck that disables her powers. And this caught her off guard, because when he did this, she was totally incapacitated. And when this happened, T'Challa heard all the commotion and he rushed over to see what it was. And initially, he had assumed the worst, but Killmonger revealed that his plan was to kill T'Challa and take Storm for his own bride. And at this point, Killmonger already went behind the scenes and cleaned out the rest of T'Challa's family, along with substantial members of the government who would have been involved in choosing the next person to take the throne. And choosing to do this at the time of his wedding, he catches T'Challa off guard and assassinates him on the balcony in front of the whole country. And this is where we find out that him being here and being arrested in Wakanda was not a coincidence, because this version of Storm made plans with Killmonger to get T'Challa's guard down, wipe out his family and the government, because she knew once that was done, the people would choose her for their next ruler. And Killmonger just assumed, since he did all the work, that she was gonna choose him to rule by her side. But more or less, she was just like, that doesn't make any sense. Why would I choose the man that murdered my fiance in front of the whole nation to rule by my side? Like, that's not gonna work. But soon after, she went over to T'Challa's body, she's crying these fake tears over him, and the people are like, she surely loved him, so she should be the next queen. And she was like, no, I shouldn't. Well, okay, since you insist, I'll do it. Man, oh man. And that is how she finessed Wakanda in the 161 universe. Man, I'm telling you guys, I'm gonna leave a link in the description, backgroundsearch.com. Now I'm just playing, I made that up. But if it works, man, tell them I sent you, I might get something. No, I'm playing, no, I'm serious. But that'll do it for this video. But if you enjoyed the video or learned something new, smash that like button. If you just thought it was okay or you didn't like it, just press the like button regularly. Those are the only two options. But we will be revisiting the 161 universe very soon, because I still gotta let you guys know what Wolverine saw in that closet. Plus, we have another Panther who we have not talked about yet on this channel who will be coming after Storm. And if you guys already know who it is, no spoilers in the comments, please. I got links up at the end for new videos. If you're new to the channel, do subscribe so you can catch these spills every week. And I'll catch you guys on the next one. Later.